So I'm here to welcome you to the third and final panel. I think it's been a great day. I've been hearing and evening yesterday from so many of you, and I myself have been jotting notes like crazy. I think everything we've heard has been, for me at least, very inspiring in terms of thinking about all of the work that we've seen and how, you know, all of us, it may generate new projects and fresh work. So I just want to take this opportunity to thank everyone who has already presented, because it's been fantastic. My interest in tours and all of the work that you've seen presented comes out of my background, which is as an architectural historian. I think often those of us who are interested in engaging the public with architecture find it very difficult, because most of the time the public learns about architecture through photographs, through magazines, through online encounters, and when they are actually in the place, there's not a way to educate them or engage with them. So that's sort of my background and my interest in a lot of this work. I think Mark Ruppel talked about this as well today. It feels too like we're at a moment where the first generation of some of this work has happened, which has been very text heavy, about putting a lot of text into mobile apps. And it feels as though we're also sort of at a turning point where seeing some of these apps as archives is shifting, and our notion is sort of shifting more towards seeing them as repositories of stories and experiences. So I think a lot of the people that we've seen are really pushing, pushing the technologies in that direction. It's really exciting to see. I think the only other thing I want to say is that, having seen some of this work, it's such challenging work to do. And I'm so impressed with the people that we've seen. But I think for those of us who come to this thinking, whether you're a scholar or you work in a cultural organization or a museum, or you're an artist, or you just have a historical place or a site in mind and you want to create a tour for it, this work takes a team. It's very hard to do it by yourself. And that's very challenging. It's hard to put together that team. It's hard to know how to do it. So I think that there are so many challenges to doing this work, and I hope that some of what you've heard and will continue to hear kind of breaks down some of those challenges and makes this work that may be something that all of us can think about doing a little bit more easily. That's it. So I'd like to introduce the next panel, and I look forward to moderating a great final discussion with them. And thank you all so much for coming. It's been a great day and evening yesterday so far.
Postdoctoral fellow in digital public humanities at the John Nicholas Brown Center for Public Humanities and Cultural Heritage. It's a lot of words, but I did. Look at my business card, and I'm a Mets fan. We have three games until the playoffs. Very exciting. So Jim Matthews is the person I'm introducing. All of this information is taken from the internet, so it's not my words. So Jim Matthews is the educational director of the Field Day Lab, an interdisciplinary team at the Wisconsin Institute of Discovery at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. The Field Day specializes in mobile media, video games, and simulation. And check out the Field Day's website, because I think they're doing a lot of cool stuff. They're really invested in learning through making, and they are helping students make their own games. There's an interesting poetry project that I saw on the site there. And they're designing open source tools, which is really important. So Jim designs and researches digital media, games, geolocative stories, situated documentaries, and learning experience aimed at connecting youth and adults with their local community. As a research and design consultant, Jim partners with museums and other nonprofit organizations to make my phone disappear, looking to integrate place-based learning and youth design experiences into their program. So here's Jim.
We almost had a fight there on the steps, yeah, because I'm a Cubs fan. lucky, this is actually the last slide of my presentation, so thank you. I'm done. That was easy. No, I'm just teasing. So thanks a lot, organizers. This is an amazing event. I was said to a couple of people, I feel like I'm at a festival and not so much a conference, which is a great feeling. Also to the other presenters, I'm borrowing some of your ideas and also just the language and the way that we're talking about these things. There's so much new material coming out, new projects, and even new frameworks and theoretical underpinnings for this work that are sort of advancing. So it's really been a great combination of speakers. So I'm an associate researcher, education director, and designer. I wear multiple different types of hats. Very often at some conferences, you have to try to give your technology. People give presentations about their technology chops because they want to show that they have these technology chops. But after listening to the speakers the last couple days, I have the opposite sort of feeling, which is that I want to say, well, I actually go out and do performance stuff, and I actually talk to people and work with people and that kind of thing as well, which is sort of an interesting dynamic. I'm going to show a really short video about a field day, and then I'm going to talk about just one specific slice of the work that we do at Field Day. About showing promotional videos, so I tell myself that an angel gets their wings every time I show. The main thing that I want to pull from that video, even though it shows a lot of high-tech things, is that we're also really interested in what are the analog tools and experiences that are connected to these digital tools that we're building. Because ultimately what we care about is getting people engaged with their community, giving them situated learning experiences, giving them different ways of perceiving and interacting with the world. The other thing is that you'll see a couple themes that come through, and they've been mentioned here. So one is learning through design. Instead of me building things, I see myself as someone who helps build tools so that other people can build things. The other is games and simulations, and then the third is field research, and what types of activities and tools do we want to build to encourage people to get out and support them when they go out to do a field work, and how do you bring these three things together in different ways? So the tool that I'm going to talk about, the platform I'm going to talk about, this is just one example of what that might look like, is called ARIS, Augmented Reality Interactive Storytelling. And you can use this tool, which is an open source project. So the tool is also free to use, and the code you can get from GitHub. But really, the goal of this is to provide a tool that people can use to create tours, interactive stories, and games, and sort of explore what this even means and what are the interconnections and intersections between these things, like a game and a tour or an interactive story. There is a client side of this, and so it goes to the server. One of the things that I love about ARIS that I think separates it from a lot of other software that is out there that allows you to do this is that you can actually build things where there's a shared world. So imagine an example that you would build a game where there was one gold piece on the stage and we were all logged into that game, and the first person that ran up here and picked up that gold coin virtually actually took it out of the world and put it into their inventory in their backpack. So in that case, you can create things where you have events where, let's say, for example, we had a tour that had 20 stops on it, but in order to unlock the last 10 stops on it, we had to have people collect 20 coins around the city, and then once those were collected, you can unlock an event. So the nice thing about that is it's not me as a single person necessarily going out and engaging with this design, but you can have a world that has consequences for all the players in it. You can do both. You don't have to design things like that, but that's one of the things that it does allow you to do. And then the other side is that if you're going to have people do things where they learn through design, you have to help develop the experiences, the activities, the language, et cetera, for them to design things. And so Aristos also have an online platform, or end of the platform, which is an offer that allows you to create things. There are a wide range of people using Aristos, and for different reasons. Sort of divide these into two sort of broad categories, although there's some hybrid between the two. So you can do location-based things, where you walk up to something and you're triggered because of your GPS position. This is where some of the crowd here, there's this sort of anti-QR code thing was happening, so you're supposed to boo and hiss at this particular slide. But I actually pushed back on that just a little bit, and there's a couple really main reasons. I've seen some people using QR codes in some really creative ways, that's one. There's a logistical piece, but then also because we're trying to introduce new people into this world to explore these things, I don't want to shut down immediately and say to somebody, you shouldn't use QR codes, or QR codes are X, because it actually is an entry point for many people that we're working with. It's their first step into this world, and I think we want to keep that conversation open. Let them learn why they should boo and hiss or cheer based on their own experience, not me necessarily telling them that these things are not good or not. But you can also build non-location-based things. So what if you want to build an interactive story or a game that takes place on Mars? You can do that using on-screen navigation, so you can click on any of those icons up there. You can use QR codes, and I'll give an example of how you can use QR codes to maybe take an exhibit out and travel it across the United States or elsewhere, and then you can also use alphanumeric codes. Alphanumeric codes are sometimes used as gates for people. So imagine if you have 20, 25, 30 students who are doing something, they're out in the community, you give them a little bit of time to run free, and then you could say check back in, and in order to advance the story or the game, you actually need an alphanumeric code that I have, and when you get to that point and we do a debrief session or we have a conversation, I'll give you that, and then it'll allow you to continue. One of the equations, I think that a lot of app developers or particular platforms where there's authoring components to it have to deal with this combination of low threshold, high ceiling, what's the complexity of what you can build, and then also the wide walls of how many features do you have and what type of interactions and dynamic interactions and mechanics can people build using this tool. So, you're not going to ding all of these at the level 10, so you always have to make these decisions about what are the trade-offs when you go to low access. That might have some implications for the high ceiling and vice versa. So we always kind of find a little bit of a sweet spot. One of the things that's great about Aris is there's a potential for middle school, elementary school students and teachers to have built things with Aris. But then we also have, and Mark pointed out earlier today, Play the Past used Aris as sort of the backbone, and then with some additional development, we're able to create an Aris-based simulation that was attached to an exhibit that they had. And in this case, you actually see a young person holding a mobile device. He's playing as a miner. He's at an exhibit where he's mining, and as he's mining, it's giving him money that he can spend at other places around in the museum space. They also go, there's another exhibit that's attached to it, or another part of the exhibit, where there's a fur trading station, and you physically, you choose if you want to be a fur trader or you want to work at the shop and buy and sell fur. So you go out with the mobile device, you're playing as a fur trader, and you actually have to go and collect pelts, and then you bring them back. So there's actually a trading system that is in that museum space of people collecting and then trading things. And you have to interact with other folks who are at the exhibit. So how do you help make these types of things happen? We can't do it with our small staff. And so there are two really key points. One is a dispersed community, and the other is a distributed community. So the dispersed community means that there are people that are building things in different locations around the world, And one of the nice things about that is it also brings in different perspectives, different needs, different challenges, different design solutions as well. One of the key things that we do is we do have online discussion spaces. We hold Google Hangouts. We also do things like have a global summit where we bring people together face-to-face who are users of the software, talking about the challenges, ideas, how do we move forward as a team to make decisions about what gets developed and doesn't get developed. Distributed community is equally, if not more important, because what you're trying to design for is to bring together people who are, and some folks wear multiple hats. So someone might be an educator and a researcher or a designer. All educators are designers, but in terms of mobile media designers. So bringing these folks together with the goal of creating open educational resources, that if there is code that gets built, if there are artifacts that get built of some sort, like an activity, a how-to, if there are media resources, we want to try to promote using Creative Commons so that these resources are shared within the community. And again, a lot of that conversation happens at these types of summits, face-to-face type things or online meetings. Originally, and I think I shouldn't say, well, originally Aorist was developed. Dave Gagnon and I were in a graduate class with Kurt Squire, who's a game scholar. It was a design-based research class. And one of the things I worked, this was sometime in the mid-2000s, and Michael was talking about the, I love this picture of the old iPad, I think it was an iPad, a PDA. When I first built something that was mobile and you went out, I was working at that time with Eric Klopfer and this crew at MIT. And in order to make something that was geolocative, I had to go out and collect the GPS coordinates by hand and then scan a map and then bring those together and hope that they were actually close enough so that you could get somebody to go to a location at some point. So I always use that as one of the excuses for why my early designs were not very good, as I spent all my time trying to get GPS coordinates. Dave Gagnon said, you know, at that time we also said we need additional prototyping tools that allow people to explore and experiment with these ideas. And so the commitment was to say, let's continue to build a tool so that we can spend our resources and energy in providing a platform that gives us more designers, hopefully a wider range of design problems and solutions, versus taking our resources and then we are going to build this one thing that's super beautiful, right? And it's not that one of those is, they just have different trade-offs go in each of those routes. And our commitment is to building something that is a prototyping tool that has a low threshold and that hopefully leads to transdisciplinary work as well as facilitates a range of people doing design work and running into the problems and also having really nice solutions. One of the ways that we do this and try to promote this type of work is by running game jams. So you're all invited to on October 23rd and 4th, we're having the dispersed global game jam. So if someone in Providence or multiple people in Providence wanted to host the site over 2 days, you just sort of challenge yourself to design a game or an interactive story or a tour using Aorist over those 2 days. And as a community then, we share all what it is that we learn from that, both in terms of end products, but also in terms of the process. And you can go to our website, aoristgames.org, in order to learn more information about that jam. So I'm going to shift at this point, since I've talked about this idea of building a tool for other people to make things. What becomes really interesting then is what are the things that people make? And why do they make them? And I also want to put on here is that folks are making things on a trajectory from being novice designers to having something under their belt to becoming more expert designers as they move on. So one of the things that I'm really curious about is just sort of trying to track that trajectory as a designer, watching other people as designers. What are the sort of moves they make and what are some of the aha moments they make as they move from sort of insider to outsiders to insiders, both in our community as well as just thinking about the discourse around mobile games and stories and that thing. So Craig Grumwell is a high school teacher. In a very short amount of time, I'd say probably in 8 months, learned about Aorist and then won a national award in Canada for this design called the Lemon 1941, which takes place, he built it just for his own high school class, studying history, and so it's based in their neighborhood around the school. And it uses real archival footage and data from 1941, when there are people becoming, who are starting to enlist in the Canadian military in order to fight in World War II. And so in this case, you role play as a student in 1941, you learn about the recruiting as well as all the types of organizations around military recruitment, and also some of the dialogue that was happening at that time in your community. You also walk around and see these places and go to houses where young people in 1941 actually lived who enlisted. So you start to get a little bit of a sense, and he talks about this with his own students, that this is something that happened in our neighborhood. This house is somebody who enlisted in the war, went off to war, and didn't make it back into this neighborhood. So you play through this, and then ultimately the game ends with you having to make a decision as the player of whether you want to enlist in the military or not. And of course, from a historical teaching standpoint, one of the great things about this is it gives you a moment where you can start to say, we don't want to advocate for presentism, which is that, oh, I'm going to do X or Y using my own contemporary current thinking, right? You have to try to then transport yourself of what was the thinking in 1940. Jewish time jump is another example. One of the things about this is that it's a much higher production in terms of historical research, et cetera. It takes place in New York City. Most of you, I'm sure, are familiar with Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire. You travel back in time as a reporter in order to cover this story. This was Owen Gottlieb's dissertation project. So one of the other nice things that we're beginning to see are more PhD students who are using ARIS as a tool for design-based research dissertations. Some of this is coming from different disciplines as well. So folks that are doing ecological studies, people that are doing humanities, particularly in the history area as well. Matera is a project that Chris Holden and Julie Sykes worked on in Albuquerque. And one of the challenges was, in New Mexico, they're teaching Spanish classes, students are sitting in Spanish classes, they're talking to each other, and yet outside their door, there are people who have been speaking Spanish in Albuquerque for hundreds of years, and it's actually a language that's spoken all the time in the community, but there's this real disconnect between what's happening in the classroom and what's happening out in the world. So they're, in terms of ARIS specifically, Chris and Julie have launched a whole group of people who are interested in using these types of tools for language learning. Some of it is indigenous language and teaching young people about that the traditions of language in their own communities. Some of it is trying to create scenarios where you have a little bit more of a situated understanding of how the language is used in situ, in neighborhoods. So this is an example where they're going out. This is also one that takes place historically, in the sense of you are charged with trying to find out about this murder. And in order to understand the language and who might have done this murder, you have to understand this one part of learning Spanish language and the difference between how you talk to somebody who is in formal language versus formal language based on their role. Freedom Summer is another project. This was, Shannon had mentioned this thing of, so how do you bring people in if you already have events? Maybe you can have these mobile activities being offshoots that amplify or speak to some of these events. So 50th anniversary of Freedom Summer, organizing free activities in Oxford, Ohio. There was a project going on to have people come back there and tell stories, et cetera. And some of the folks that work at the university, Miami University, said, why don't we build something with ARIS in order to have folks sort of role play as if they are going to be their students coming to Oxford to be trained to go down south. And so you actually go to the locations where these trainings took place and you go through these mini activities or mini trainings around nonviolent communication as an example, and interventions, and how do you approach people who are from the south and you're from the north. And you sort of go through these little modules, and at the end of this experience, you have to actually decide whether you're going to get on the bus in order to go there. So one thing that I really like about this is that it's taking, instead of trying to tell the entire story, it's only taking one moment of that trajectory. I think of it in film, the example might be, I just watched the NWA film that covers a large amount of their careers versus a film like 8 Mile, which takes place in about a week, right? So you can take a unit or the scale of it, the time scale of that is a much shorter time scale. And that's something that people are beginning to wrestle a little bit in terms of storytelling with ARIS. How big of a chunk do you take up? Sustainable U, I'll talk about because it starts to integrate another thing that we're working on is the integration of actual mini games into the spaces. So this is a dystopian future on UW-Madison's campus. And you are charged with sort of saving the world by understanding sustainable practices. One of the things that you do is you actually go around, there's a tour of the infrastructure on campus that uses QR codes. You do a little bit of documentation, so you do some assessment of how good the community is doing or how good individuals are doing in terms of sustainable practices. But you can also then play these little mini games. They're not deep at all. One of them, as an example, is you throw sweaters at people because they're trying to turn up the heat in their apartment, and instead of having them turn up the heat, you throw sweaters at them. Others are about changing the pavement so that it soaks up more water. These are dispersed around campus, so in theory, you would go to this location, learn about the infrastructure, and then play a mini game about that infrastructure, and then do some data collection. All of these originally are associated with classes that are actually studying this thing. So you think about it as a field experience then that is being done as part of this class. Upriver, I think, is the last project that I'll talk about. This is a project that I was involved in doing more design work in the St. Louis River estuary, which is between Duluth and Superior on Lake Superior. And the challenge was that there was a lot of really rich scientific data that was being collected in this particular watershed, but people that lived in the area didn't know about this data. So one of the ideas was to think, how might we work with scientists to get people to care about this data, care about the issues that this data was bringing to life, and also interpret the data in some way? And so it was bringing together, a lot of the work I did was as an ethnographer and going out into the community and doing ethnographic work. It brought together stories with the scientific data. You start in a harbor area, you move to the industrial flats, and then you go further upriver to what it might have looked like pre-European settlement. What you do in this is you role play. You're given a role as a task from a chef who said, I'd like you to build a meal for me using native species from this watershed. And it's really difficult to do, if not impossible. So you try to go, you go virtually fishing and you can catch a walleye, which is native, but you also might end up catching invasive species. You learn about scientific data. I won't tell you what that is, but that used to be called Turd Bay because all the waste actually would go right into that bay. But since they put in the water treatment plant that dissolved, the oxygen levels have gone up, which is really good for fish. In order to get help, you can talk to historical characters who lived in that area or did research in that area and documented the area. Really quick thing about this, though, is that it also integrated doing field work and data collection as part of the tour or interactive story. So you went out and you gathered data, both scientific data as well as cultural data, and did interviews, so it was generating new content. And then you built your own sort of extension. We can think of it as sort of an expansion pack. A shift then thinking about tourists as producer, or a tourist is just consuming, but actually a tourist as a producer of new knowledge, and then also integrating data collection, documentation into mobile-based tours. Learning through design, just really quickly, if I go out and build this, the amount that I learn by getting, not only about design, but about the content and the stories, right? That's why we love doing this work. All of us that are in this room is because we love the stories, we love meeting people, we like getting out into the community. So what does it then look like if you have other people? In my case, I'm particularly interested in young people and the trajectory they go through as designers, studying invasive species. This is a prototype of what became later a digital version of an invasive species game, or working with graduate students who are doing a game around affordable housing in Madison, Wisconsin. It's not only then about learning the content, but it's also learning about how do I go through this design process. It's dealing with all the questions that are coming up today. So why we shouldn't only have folks at universities talking about this, we should have elementary schools talking about representation and how do I build things that are going to engage people, or what are the trade-offs if I use this tool versus this tool because of different affordances. Okay, I will stop there. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Caroline Stevens. I'm a master's student in public humanities, and I'm pleased to introduce Dietrich Naumann, one of the most popular professors at Brown University, where he teaches architectural history and directs the urban studies department. Students love Dietrich for how he brings architecture to life in an exciting and accessible way. And this passion and skill is also seen in Brown Facades, the campus guide app he developed for Brown University. It happens to be one of the best platforms for digital exploration of architecture I've seen, and I encourage you to download it all now, because you're all exploring Brown as you're here, I hope. He is now also the editor for the Campus Guide app series for the Princeton Architectural Press. Welcome, Dietrich.
Thank you, Caroline, for the kind introduction. I have to quickly change systems here, because I wanted to show something that didn't work on the Mac. And in the meantime, I also wanted to thank Marisa and Susan, of course, for organizing this wonderful conference. I've already learned a lot, and it's such an unusual topic, but very timely. And this section, as you know, is called Behind the Scenes. So I thought I'll give you a quick look behind the scenes of this app that I developed with my students. And I'll try and lower the sound here a little bit if I can do this up here. I had this idea for, I like to not teach the same seminar all the time, every year or every second year. And I was thinking maybe I should teach a class that has as its topic a campus architecture guide. Very naively, I thought, maybe we can put something together, and I started laying it out, and then I suddenly heard that an alumnus, Brown, Ray Reinhardt, had already had the same idea and was in the middle of writing one, and he had secured an enormous amount of money from an alumna and had talked to Princeton Architectural Press that he was going to do this guidebook in their series. And so I thought, again, very naively, I'll just switch around and make an app with my students. And so I announced that class, we'll do an app. And of course, at that point, I had no idea what that entailed. And I'll share a little bit with you in a moment. As I said, I was very naive. And as probably Jim, his apps actually look much more complex than what I've put together here. Jim can probably attest to the fact that it's much more work than one thinks in one's worst nightmares. So I announced this class that I was going to do an app with the students, and they all signed up, and we had 20 students, and it was all nice. And so I assigned all the buildings I could think of on campus, and the poor students had to write up an entry for a building every week, pretty much, and I had to then edit them. At that moment, there was a moment of rather uncomfortable development, because somebody called me from Princeton Architectural Press, who was in the middle of the production of this guidebook by Ray Reinhardt for Brown's campus, and said, "Can we talk?" And that already didn't sound very good, and so we met here in the Robert Center and sat down, and somewhat understandably, they said, "You know, we have this book project that we're working on, and if you create an app that is in a way a competition to us, and we're not very happy about this, and can you reconsider?" I said, "No, I can't, because I've already announced the class, and we're in the middle of it, but we could maybe work with Mr. Reinhardt to put it all together, but he was already half finished at that point, so that didn't work either, and so we just went ahead with it." Of course, it was in the end a little more cumbersome and slower, but this is my wonderful group of students, and they had to deliver their little essays every week. But what I hadn't really anticipated was that I had to edit them every week as well. So I started going in and writing and rewriting and thinking and discussing with the students. Here, just an example, there's this wonderful building by Philip Johnson, the first building here on campus that he did. He did two, the List Art Center is another one. And so here's the student writing about it, and I sort of begin thinking, you know, how could one put this better and shorter, and all this, found this great photograph of Philip Johnson in his office in the Seagram building, and what he has on his desk for this photograph for Time Life is actually a little model of our computer center that he built in the late 50s here on campus, just down the street at the corner of George. And then in the research, which was the great fun for me, of course, we discover all kinds of interesting details, such as the fact that there is a tapestry hanging inside this computer center that Philip Johnson actually had donated to Brown, and it's a tapestry by a man called Urshel Gorky, who is one of the great abstract expressionists in post-war America. And it turned out, which I found out by a little looking, and then I worked with a student, and we put it all in the text, that Urshel Gorky, here's the tapestry a little closer, that he actually had lived in Providence for 2 or 3 years when he arrived from Armenia. So all of this was great stuff, and I learned as much or probably more than anyone else involved in this app. So that was a wonderful experience, but a lot, really seriously, a lot of work. And then we had an idea that we developed in class that I'm still very proud of, the idea of so-called ghost buildings. And ghost buildings are, in our definition, buildings that used to be on campus but aren't anymore, right? So we found all these black and white photographs of buildings that were taken down and used by Brown, but then had to make room for other buildings. And somewhat sadly, in fact, the Caroline mentioned that I'm director of Urban Studies. The Urban Studies building on 29 Manning is about to become a ghost building because the engineering school is enlarging there, and it's going to come down very soon. We have a little commemorative spray painting action going on later this afternoon. But so we introduced ghost buildings, both buildings that were here but aren't anymore, to commemorate those, and then also buildings that were meant to be here but didn't make it, like I.M. Pei, the young I.M. Pei, the great architect of the National Gallery of Art, designed a wonderful geomath building for Brown in 1969. And I always tell my students, you see that sharp angle there, that corner there, that sort of is very acute? I'm telling them this is where he tried out that corner for the National Gallery in Washington, D.C. I'm not sure if it's true, but Brown ran out of money, and so they never got around to building this thing, unfortunately. But it was beautiful. Look at this interior arcade. So we felt this all should go into this little app that we devised. And so then the next step was to put all of the information after the text had been shortened into a huge database. At that point, I had found a developer and had found a photographer. And so all of these things had to come together, and the text, here you see it in very small print, had to be linked with the geodata and the titles and everything that was going to go in there. And the photographer, Hassan Bagheri, I don't know if he managed to come today. Maybe he's in the audience. Wonderful, wonderful man, one of the greatest. Is he there somewhere?
He's over there.
He's over there. So thanks for coming, Hassan, one of the great architectural photographers of our time. And he just went around and took photographs of the campus, made it look beautiful. We had one of those springs where you have no leaves on the trees yet, but blue skies. And he just went around and photographed the whole campus and made it look perhaps even more beautiful than in reality. Here you go. So I'll just show you a few of those. The old library, now the economics department, and wonderful interiors. A little clue for this class was to keep the students entertained was that every week we met in a different location on campus that in most cases wasn't familiar to them, and I would only give them the clue where they had to go the next day, the night before. There was always that secretive little email, tomorrow we'll meet at this and this address, and then they all had to find it in time, and we, you know, sat in all of these interiors, not here, that we left on the pool, but pretty much everything else we sat in and debated put this whole thing together. And then, as I said, I had a wonderful software developer, Gökçe Kınayoğlu, Hasan Bagheri, the photographer, and Gökçe Kınayoğlu, the developer. And we needed to raise a little more funds to make this whole thing a reality, and so he put a little film together that we then showed the administration at Brown to get a little more money, and he did a wonderful job. And the students came up with the name, which you can see here, Brown Facades, which is an acronym for Facts About Campus Architecture, Design, Environment, and Spaces. Fantastic. So that's what Brown Facades stands for. And here we go. And he put this together and showed, in a way, the interface and then the way the whole thing works. And you get in. This is the first version. We have, of course, had a few updates in the meantime. And you have search filters, and you have the whole list of 130 buildings, and then you can go into the map, for instance, where you have those great icons to see where you are. I can actually, of course, enlarge this a little bit. You can see where you are. You can browse around campus. The symbols tell you if you're looking at the dorm or at a administrative building or a classroom building, and then you can slide through the images, and of course you can scroll through the text. So it's a fairly simple arrangement, much simpler perhaps than what Jim has put together there. But it was fun and, as I said, much more work than I had initially anticipated. So we worked together very closely, Gökçe and I. I'll just go a little further here. We have custom search filters where you can look for architects, and you can look for things in a certain distance, or you can look for certain time brackets. And so you can look for architects and search by architects, et cetera, et cetera. So it's quite a good, useful tool. He developed that for us. And then we launched the app. And here it's the demonstration of how you can choose certain time brackets. And so you get the idea. It's a very simple and useful interface. I think keyword search, all of this is possible. And so I'll leave it at that for the filter. I wanted to just show you how the story then continued. So we put it all out, and we advertised it in the Brown Daily Herald, on the PDH blog, had something about the East Side Monthly, even mentioned it. The Province Journal mentioned it very briefly, unfortunately, only in the sideline. But anyway, so we rolled it out, and then I realized it wasn't enough. So we printed postcards that we put at the admissions office, and when people come and visit the campus, to alert them to the fact that this existed. And so we printed lots of those. All of this has to be designed and printed and financed. And then finally, we rolled it out. That was October 2013, and we get these wonderful graphs here from Apple every month. And you can see October 2013, the huge spike in downloads. And altogether, as you can see here, we've had 2,796 downloads, which makes me very happy. I think, at least to me, it sounds like a really enormous number. And you can see here that first, the biggest number is from the United States, 87%, closely followed by China with 3.9%, and then United Kingdom, Canada, France, Turkey, et cetera, et cetera. Even Algeria, we have a few downloads. And then you can see that the downloads continue. Whenever you in a fairly low level, whenever you see a spike, there was some sort of advertising done on our part, mentioning it in another newspaper or so on. And then we have a few more downloads. So I hope you'll lead to another spike in the next iteration. And what is also fascinating is, of course, to see where in the world people download and how long their screen views are, how long they spend looking at this thing. And obviously the United States are leading, but as you can see here, there are a few in Russia and in South Africa as well. And of course, it's closer to home. Extremely interesting to see the download numbers in the United States here for East Coast, West Coast. I'm a little disappointed in North Dakota. There's not a single download so far, but hopefully we'll get there. So. And then, of course, you can divide the whole thing up. Apple does all of this for you. You can see which buildings were looked at the most and the longest and by whom, etc. And the average screen time with this thing is 34 seconds, which seems like very little, but apparently it's very much in the world of mobile technology. And the building that got the most hits is actually Sharper Factory, which is has the nickname the Ratty. It's our big food place where the students go. So that was the building that they were most interested in, and I can say quite frankly, it's architecturally probably one of the least interesting buildings of campus. So it didn't quite fulfill the purpose that I had hoped it would, but anyway, it's a fascinating enterprise. And so I'll just quickly move on because I want to end on time, and then something almost magical happened. The Brown University Guide came out, and I think it came out beautifully. Ray Reinhardt wrote it. I ended up writing a little introduction to it, and it's beautifully done, and I think it's handed out to all the alums, and it's sold in the bookstore. And then I got another call from Princeton Architectural Press. And it sounded a little less ominous somehow. And they said, you know, we looked at your app and it's really quite nice. And so we have a proposal for you. Would you like to design apps for all our guides in the whole series of university architecture guides? And I said, oh, that's actually a nice turnaround of events. And so we are now great friends, and we've done the Illinois Institute of Technology app together. And here it is, and it's basically based on a very similar pattern. And I thought I'd try the little technological trick. Do I have a little time left?
Yeah.
Little,
yeah.
Two or three minutes. Let me quickly see if I can make this work. And I think the gentleman in the back might kindly lower the sound a little bit. So I want to just quickly show you the IoT app, since you already got a good impression of the app at Brown. So, you know, we introduced the man, the architect who was responsible for most of the campus buildings in Chicago at the Illinois Institute of Technology, a man called Ludwig Mies van der Rohe. from Germany, and I'm a great admirer of his work. And then you can go into the map, and you have different icons there. And you can, for instance, click on Crown Hall, which is the most important piece of architecture there on campus. And you see here the text, which is, in this case, because it's such an important building, a little on the long side. And then you have our photographs. We also built in something which is a neat effect. When you turn it sideways, the photographs get bigger. And once again, Hassan Bagheri did the photography. And I added a few more photographs from other sources, because the original printed book on which this was based didn't have very good photography. And then you can scroll through the building and get to a few historic images and interiors, and seeing how the whole thing was built. And then we discovered something very interesting already for the Brown app, for the first update, the interesting fact that, in fact, there was a little plugin, and you could have the text read to you by Siri. You're all familiar with Siri, right? And it made sense for us, because Siri, that is a fact, that's actually true, but not many people know about it. Siri actually went to Brown University, which is, for those who know it, a source of great pride, meaning the woman who spoke all those thousands of words that the software then puts together for those answers, she, I guess, is an actress, and she went to Brown and then got hired by Apple to speak all those words, right? So I just want to show you what it sounds like. I'll just let her read the first sentence of this.
By consensus, the most architecturally significant building on the IIT campus, and designated a Chicago landmark, SR Crown Hall was designed to accommodate the school's departments of architecture, design, and planning. Prior to its completion, Mice had been on the faculty for nearly two decades, conducting his classes.
I had to go to this point. I don't know if you noticed it. She mispronounced Mies van der Rohe. It's Mies, it's not Mice. But she went to Brown after all, but she got that wrong. So just had to point that out, and I'll quickly come to my conclusion here. Final 2 minutes of my presentation, but perhaps the most important ones. So, of course, Princeton Architectural Press, our app is obviously free, right? Brown's, we just did it and it's free, and Brown added some money to it, and so it's available for free. But of course, Princeton Architectural Press can't operate on that model, and so they put it up there. And if you look very closely, you see the price in the App Store, $9.99. I immediately wrote to them and said, I don't think that's going to apply, because if you look at what's available in app stores, nothing costs $9.99. Maybe 99 cents would be more like it. But so they said, no, let's try it out. And of course, what happened, they gave it away when we had a presentation at IIT this spring. So a lot of people downloaded it in April, and then it just completely fizzled out. So now we have to sort of reconsider how you can actually sell this app and provide some profit for the sponsoring publisher. I mean, it's a publishing business, and somehow money has to come in, and we don't know yet. We'll look into the different options, but it's a fascinating process to figure that out nowadays. So I'll just skip to my last page here very quickly. We are working on the 2.0 edition now of our app here on campus, with 100 additional buildings, art on campus, integration of social media, panoramic images. I want people, if they are in China or finally in North Dakota, to be able to actually go in and look around. And so I've been taking a lot of, thank you for your enthusiasm. So I want to include those, and that can be done. And then something, again, magical happened. Two students came to me, Sarah Clark and Thomas Quiñones Riegos. They're both here, and they said, we have a whole new idea for you. And what if we interview alums and let them tell you a story about a place that they remember at Brown? And I thought that was brilliant, and that is where I finally come to the topic of this conference, place-based storytelling. Because what we were doing was more history than storytelling, but here's the storytelling, and they gave me one of their files. I've been collecting files from alums, and I wanted to play this for you, so this will be in the 2.0. Just a short story that they got from one of the alums who had specific memories of places at Brown. Here it goes. And I think Sierra and Thomas are both in the audience somewhere. So thanks for doing this and hook up.
Jonathan Quoley Aragawa, class of 2012-05, currently associate at McKinsey & Company. Main Green. It was a beautiful spring day on the Main Green. As part of a student group called Liberty in North Korea, I was holding a bake sale near Fon's house in order to fundraise for North Korean refugees. Then someone whispered, "I heard Steven Spielberg is visiting campus." Out of excitement, I started surveying the vicinity with my teammates and shouted, "Wait, where is he now?" It was then when I realized he had been sitting on a bench just several feet away looking at me and chuckling. Having made eye contact, I had no choice but to approach him. "Mr. Spielberg, would you like to buy a cupcake for a cause?" "Sure, what kind of cause?" And so I gave a 1-minute spiel on what we were doing for North Korean refugees. He then asked for 2 cupcakes for his family. He generously donated $50.
Great, thank you very much.
I'm Sarah Dilla, and I'm a second-year master's student in the Public Humanities Program and the Curatorial Fellow for Exhibitions at the John Hay Library, which is Brown's Special Collections Library on campus. And today I'm introducing Chelsea Gunn from the Newport Historical Society. Chelsea is a PhD student at the University of Pittsburgh School of Information Sciences and holds a Master's of Library and Information Science from Simmons College, where she specialized in archives management as the archivist and manager of digital initiatives at the Newport Historical Society. Chelsea has worked with the Explore Historic Newport mobile app with an emphasis on the project management and evaluation. Previously, she served as the Rhode Island History Online Directory Initiative, abbreviated as RODI, as the project coordinator at the Rhode Island Historical Society, surveying the state's cultural heritage sites and collections. Her areas of research interest include evolution of diary keeping practices, humanities data, digital preservation, and project evolution. So you will join me in welcoming Chelsea.
So thank you guys for having me here today. It's exciting for me to be back in Rhode Island after a few months in Pittsburgh. So the way I sort of set this talk up is that it would be great for me if you could all just look at your phones and your computers the whole time. I actually was hoping that I would keep this pretty visually minimal. And if you wanted to go ahead, you can see here our app is called Explore Historic Newport. So if you go to your Google or Apple App Store, you can download it, and you can also go to newporthistoryapp.com. So I thought if you wanted to pull that up and just browse a little bit freely, you can kind of get a sense of the content, and that way I can talk a little bit more about kind of the issues that we face as an organization putting the app together and moving into a phase of evaluation now. And if you think of questions or comments, you can tweet me or NHS here. We might not have time for them in the discussion, but I'm happy to talk to you on that. So briefly, just a little bit of context before we dive in. Just a very short description of what the Newport Historical Society actually is and does. They've been in operation since 1854, and like many historical societies, they collect, preserve, and make accessible documents, artifacts, and properties related to Newport's history. More recently, in the NHS history, they've been trying to really strengthen the digital arm of the public history mission that they serve. So that includes a new open access collection management system, an online collections catalog that's currently in development, and an increasingly dynamic and responsive website, and much greater outreach and audience interactions through social media. Also included in that is an effort to use open source technology as much as possible when it's available for the purpose we're trying to serve. So, you know, beyond digital initiatives, place-based storytelling has been a really key component of how NHS does public history for a really long time. The NHS is one organization that you've seen here today that does actually offer in-person walking tours. So those range from between 20 and 60 tours a month, and they include the landscape of downtown Newport, but also indoor site tours of specific buildings. And you know, in the winter, sometimes that has an audience of 40 people a month, but in warmer high traffic seasons, it's usually around 400 people a month. So a lot of people are coming and taking walking tours in person. And I'm including this because I think this is a really, I think this sums up the NHS really well. And I just pulled it directly from our website. But I think this is really key to this kind of work. So as a small organization with significant holdings and a large mission, it's specifically a component of the NHS's strategic plan to work as much with other organizations as possible to expand its reach. We are boundless collaborators. I think that with digital projects, I think most people have touched on this a little bit today, there's always some element of collaboration, whether it's with just members of your own staff. A small organization doesn't necessarily have dedicated tech or digital initiative staff. They do, it might be one person, so it's always really a team effort to do this sort of work. And as much as possible, we like to also work with other organizations. And there's also an element of collaboration that happens with software developers and people you work with to actually put the nuts and bolts of these projects together. So collaboration is really important to us. So the app, as it came to actually exist, it was released in 2012, and it's been a cross-platform native app and web app from the very beginning. And the impetus for the project actually came from a member of the NHS Board of Directors, and who felt that at that time a mobile app would be a really meaningful digital project and mode of outreach. So the initial funding to launch the app came through a Kickstarter campaign. I think that's noteworthy because Kickstarter campaigns can kind of serve as initial marketing initiatives in and of themselves. So in addition to funding, you also get an audience built in that's ready and waiting for your product. So that's always a good thing. The ongoing support of the app is actually sponsored by a local real estate company. And so if you're looking through the app, you might notice an About Our Sponsor section. And you can go to that and you actually see property listings of historic homes that are currently available in Newport, and you get a little bit of a house history there. And I mentioned those things because I don't think we always talk about funding and support in that way when we talk about the digital work that we're doing, but there are usually multiple stakeholders in these projects and lots of sets of expectations, and I think it's always good to think about that and think about how your app is serving the full community of people invested in its development. So for us, working with a real estate company makes sense because house history and architectural history is something that the NHS already does and does really well, so that's, I think, a logical and easy match, a way to get support from someone who shares interests with us. If you're looking through the app, you probably have immediately a pretty good sense of what's in it, but just briefly, it is designed basically to allow visitors to Newport or armchair visitors from anywhere in the world to take an annotated walk around the city and learn a little bit about Newport history. It currently focuses on downtown Newport and includes over 75 historic sites. And the tours are arranged, you can see here, chronologically, but also by thematic content. And as with a lot of the other tours we've seen today, it does employ a GPS interactive map. So you can open it up in downtown Newport and the map will pinpoint where you're standing and orient you to historic sites nearby. So in that way, it's it can be a linear tour, but it can also just be a sort of quick historical reference. And so I mentioned earlier that the well-established program of place-based narratives that's already present at the NHS really informed this project. In some ways, doing tours in person is a really great advantage because you already have your content pretty well mapped out. The information architecture is kind of established, and especially for a small institution, that really lightens the load of developing this sort of project. It makes a lot of sense to start with something you already know and do really well. But on the flip side, I think it's important to consider that, you know, some people have alluded to this, you don't want to create something that's in competition with what you're already doing. And so you want to think about how this project functions within the existing landscape of programmatic offerings that you already have, and make sure that it's complementary to what you're doing in person. Also, in addition to the place-based tours, I think it's worth noting that this app includes some collection space to exhibits. So what's really great about tools like this is if you're an archival institution, a lot of your holdings are behind closed doors for preservation purposes. So, thanks. So, a lot of things that people don't have access to in person on a daily basis can be made immediately more accessible by putting them into an interface like this, and that's really exciting. I think that other advantages of the mobile tour, as we've seen earlier today, is that it kind of opens up what you're already offering. So this allows visitors to experience tours that we've developed without actually maybe being in Newport during business hours, or maybe there are accessibility issues that make going on the walking tour challenging. So someone could really have a similar experience without having to leave their house, and that's a really nice thing. The other kind of cool thing about it, like I said, the GPS lets you really open up the app and start anywhere you want, which I think can be really great for people who maybe are, you know, they don't have time to do the full tour, or they're not sure that they want to commit to that, or they're only interested in the specific aspect of that particular tour. So that allows for greater flexibility. But because narrative is really important to the app, the material that we've put into it is, you know, a lot of time and effort went into creating that story. And we believe that narrative is really important to public history as a whole. So if one of the advantages of the app is that users can kind of skip in and out, then we have to also think about how we balance that with maintaining context and narrative, and that's sometimes challenging. So I'm including this. This is an advice originally intended for art students, but I think it's really important to digital projects as well, although extremely hard to follow. What I think I mean by it in this context is that while you're actually in the development phase, once you've sort of decided what you want to do, it can be really tempting to preemptively anticipate the user experience or the user needs and keep adding new features. And you kind of end up with a lot of design creep and mission creep, and eventually your finished product is very sprawling, and that makes it a lot harder to evaluate after you've actually had users interacting with it. So I think that once you have your design in place, it's really good to stick to it as much as possible and let the project just live in the wild for a little bit, and then you can actually start to evaluate it after that. For better or worse, these things aren't permanent, so it's going to continue to live and grow, and it's not necessary to pack every possible feature into your very first version. And I think it's also, on a similar note, important to keep in mind that digital isn't synonymous with instant. So as with analog projects, the development is time-consuming and ongoing, and it's only really after a substantial period of implementation that you can really undertake a meaningful evaluation. And so that's kind of where we at the NHS are right now. So one of the most obvious parts of evaluation is, of course, considering the user experience. And so I mentioned earlier that the app was developed to be a native app and also a web app for mobile browsing devices. And the key thing that I'm leaving out there is that it's not optimized for desktop browsers. So if you're looking on a laptop right now, you'll notice something a little bit like this. You'll see a pretty large image that you have to scroll down through to see the full file. And I don't think that's really necessarily in and of itself a big problem. I think with mobile websites, we see that a lot. They're just meant to be mobile, and that's fine. But when it does start to matter is when we can see through our analytics that a lot of our visitors are actually accessing the site from the desktop browser. So that's something that we might want to be thinking about as we collect data and start to ask some more questions about what we want to do next. So I won't go into extensive explanation of the analytics, but we use TorSphere to maintain our app. And so this is their built-in analytics interface. This is just sort of their overview page. And so you get a lot of, these are our stats from August this past summer. So you can kind of just get a little snapshot of how people were using this this summer. So at this point, we have a few years worth of data that we've generated from the app, and we're with that able to see some larger trends and ask some more meaningful questions. For example, I mentioned that users are not actually using the site on mobile device as much as we might have anticipated that they would. There is a fair amount of desktop browsing. So something that we might want to consider is maybe providing some content that that people are viewing, like the collections exhibits, for example. Maybe making those available in our WordPress website in another platform that's a little bit more desktop friendly. Or maybe we want to kind of split off and not link so extensively to the tour app information in our website. So I think that once you look at that data, you can kind of start to think about possible reasons why those numbers are what they are. And from there, you can plan how you want to test that. We can also see that users are using the mobile site more than they're using the native app. So from there, we might ask whether users just prefer that browsing experience, or if they're not actually aware of the native app, and maybe it's more maybe that's a thing that marketing can address. And if we look at the average time spent on each page, I think we can also leverage that against how much content is on that page. So we want to think about how much text is in each entry, and whether or not users are really reading it, or if it's like something that's more concise than that particular kind of experience. So, if someone is willing to read at home on a computer, it's different than what they might want to read while they're out walking, and we want to satisfy both experiences. Something that we want to look at when we're collecting data is making sure that we don't mistake use for impact. So while we can get a lot of information from these analytics about the use, it doesn't necessarily let us know what that means for users and how users are really responding to it. So that's something that we are interested in investigating also. And it's a little chart of how people are actually looking at our site. So I think, I touched on this already, but when we're talking about analytics and data, we want to keep in mind that the numbers are useful, but they're not really answering questions always so much as they're posing them. And the real value comes in being able to find some meaningful questions in the data that we can then ask and test. And I have to put in a small plug for the feedback section in our app. If you're looking at it, it's on our homepage, and so that is a place where if people are actually going through and looking around a little bit, we can get some more qualitative feedback beyond use and numbers. And so I think just to sort of wrap up in this explanation, I would just reinforce the idea that digital projects aren't ever really finished. They're going to go through many iterations and ideally improve with each one. Even if the content is done and we decide that that's it, there are always going to be changes in the digital environment that they live in. So platforms will change. Sometimes they change ownership, but they go away altogether, or server crashes, or the user interface gets better, or it stays static and you outgrow it and you have to migrate. As these things happen, stewards of digital content have to respond just as stewards of physical collections and exhibits do. And we have a lot of opportunities along the way to re-examine and improve what we're doing and make sure that we're best serving our mission and our audience. And I think that's a really exciting part of this kind of work. I think our executive director puts this more succinctly than I do. She'll sometimes say when we're talking about these projects, if an app isn't answer, what is the question? And I think that is a good question to leave you with. So thank you again for having me today, and please feel free to let me know if you have any questions about our app.
In my case, it was...
You were the team.
No. It was very accidental, and I was just lucky in finding Hassan, for instance, and Gökçe, who lives in Montreal, so most of these things happen anyway, online and by emails and so on, but it was a bit of a trial and error. So you try out with one developer, and turns out he isn't quite as conversant in particular issues that are important to you, and you have to move on to the next day. Isn't it good? System, and I think in the end it's sort of word of mouth, and I've recommended Gökçe to other people who love working with him, and so it's one of the things that fascinates me, that with all the digital technology, the way we actually tell each other about it, about apps for instance, or about people who work well in apps, it's usually the most old-fashioned way you can think of, which is word of mouth and recommendations and things like that. So that's how it happened to me, that people recommended them and I found them. There's nothing online where you can actually find, maybe there is, but I haven't accessed that, where you can find a good developer that can one thing or another and so on. So it's very accidental.
So two things. One is about shared resources. So I see a lot of projects where someone gets a grant to do something and then they'll have, it's sort of when the interweb first started out and you have a computer, okay, you're our web developer now, right, mm-hmm. Just in the early days. Is I think there are people who then have projects where they're taking a student hourly or someone who's on their graduate team and then building apps out of that. And it's sort of disappointing to see, not see as much where there are universities or other groups who are sharing resources across projects in some way. And I don't know exactly what that looks like, but I see that as a problem when somebody is just hiring a student hourly to program something or a graduate student because of the duration of their time and the amount of money and when that runs out, et cetera. One of the challenges that we have is I think there are people developing things using our tools, and just connecting them together and having conversations and learning from each other is one of the challenges, but one of the reasons that we also have these face-to-face sort of summits and activities as well.
I think for us it's a little bit unique because we're working with a company that specifically provides a platform. There was still a process of evaluating what our options were there. So I think one way that it's one way that that's useful is that you can actually look and see who else is using that software, and you can sort of size up what you think about how those projects look and how they function. And you can actually reach out and talk to some other library that's used TorSphere, for example, and say, what do you like about using it, what don't you? So, I mean, in that way, I think it's a little bit easier when you're working with a service versus finding an independent developer to start from scratch, because you have already a little bit of a community that you can compare and contrast with, and that's helpful for small institutions especially.
I don't know if you can share this, but I think for people who might be thinking about doing projects like this, I'm wondering if all of you could share, approximate costs, how much these project costs, the maintenance, and what you foresee in terms of the maintenance into the future, both in terms of cost, but also who does it and whose role is it going to be to take care of these things.
I'll start again. Obviously, as a professor at Brown with students who need to write entries to get a grade in a class, I have a lot of access to free labor. But, so, but on the other end, of course, there's a lot of editing on the other end. And I obviously don't have to make a living doing that, so I could put just my time into the whole thing. But we raised funds, and I would think for the first round about maybe altogether $10,000 for photography and app development. And I think in both cases I got a really, really good deal and very kind conditions from both of them. But I think it would have been hard to do anything underneath that price, and so I could find some funds here from.
Yeah, funding is definitely one of the challenges. One of the things that we have worked on is that we have sort of a service model. So we're at the university and have an open source project, but then we also have a service team that goes out. So for example, the Minnesota Historic Museum project used ARIS as the backbone, and then they paid for additional server space because they have hundreds of kids that are picking this thing up and using it on any given day. So the server space had to get larger. They also wanted features that they needed for their particular project. So they're paying for this thing, but then all of that code and all of those features go back, and server space actually goes back into the broader community so that people can use that for free who don't have the kind of money to build server spaces or even to build their own server, let alone use a server that we're supplying. So I think that sort of you have these folks with more money up here, particularly in Minnesota. The funding of humanities is kind of crazy. It almost makes me want to move there from Wisconsin, if you know about our recent political shift. But at any rate, trying to get these folks to fund some of it and then helping that supply the folks that don't have money.
And some of the games that you talked about, like Jewish Time Jump or some of the others, do you have a sense of how much it costs them to put those projects together?
Well, there are some that have been developed that there's zero cost to them outside of what they do in their, so for their classroom, they do that. Jewish Time Jump starts getting up into to five figures in the sense of the historical thing, so they're much more, Owen's much more concerned in that case also about copyright and about working with historians and then doing outreach and that type of thing. So it raises to that. Something that you're talking to the Minnesota Historic Museum as a 10-year exhibit, they're, not that the ARIS component of this, but that's a multi-million dollar project. Mm-hmm. So it sort of ranges in that area for people developing things.
I know, I'm not sure about the exact monthly costs of our ongoing maintenance, but the initial Kickstarter that we launched to start the app was for $10,000. Like I said, we're lucky to have a sponsor who supports our app. That's really great. I know that if that was to change, I think that would change. Maybe whether we decide to keep hosting a native app that's more expensive than just a web app. So I think that's something to consider moving forward. If you're not lucky enough to have some people wants to sponsor your app.
Great. Thanks. I hope that's useful information for people out there. I can take questions from the audience if anyone has any. We've got some people with microphones.
Just real quick with the Brown app, what was the tech platform for that? In other words, what was the technology that was built into all that content?
I'm afraid I don't think I can give you a very exhaustive answer. I believe that our developer used available app development technology that he downloaded from the Apple site. He started out with an iOS app and downloaded from there, and then I think there are instructions for developers of how to do that, and he taught it himself basically with online workshops and so on. That's as far as my knowledge goes, unfortunately.
Hi, this is Greg D'Onofrio again from the University of Minnesota. I'm very proud to live there. Thank you, my adopted state. A question for Jim Matthews. I'll confess, I wasn't particularly initially interested in the idea of games, and then you described them, and I thought, wow, this is incredible. I'm very attuned to the words that are used, and I wonder if in the context of, and this isn't my perspective, I'm just wondering if you've ever heard this, in the context of Jewish time jump and Freedom Summer, that the notion of playing something or performing something is somehow trivializes the history that you're trying to represent through that.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, I for a while was using the notion of situated documentary, just even thinking about as documentary form changes and as historical, you know, are we creating, I'm a fan of the movie Forrest Gump, right? So I sometimes start with that of going, is it bad that I watch Forrest Gump? I think, I would say no. I think I would want to watch that as something that's constructive and it's an interpretation of even these historical events, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there's something to say about how are you also educating the user about that and about how they're approaching history and thinking about history. And you can actually build games, I think, that encourage that type of questioning. I'm also, there's, I think, even in the Minnesota example, Barton and Levstick have done a lot of work around historic education. So as there was a shift from Sam Weinberg saying, like, we want people to think like historians. And then you start to go, do we really want to train a bunch of little historians running around? Or do we actually want to build things that get people curious so that they care about, they care for, they care about the local architecture, they care about their local community? And then as their trajectory as historians gets higher, goes higher, then we bring in more of the critical analysis and that type of thing. The last thing I'll say is that people, there's really a distinction to make between games and gamification. And I won't even go into that, but it's something that we don't want to see more gamification. I was talking to Mark, and I said, well, schools already do gamification, right? They give you grades, they have incentives, they de-incentivize you for certain things. That's gamification. That we don't care about that. We don't actually, in many cases, I don't want to see that. As opposed to thinking about what our game experiences, what our playful encounters, et cetera, et cetera. So, but your point from a critical perspective is, yeah, it's something we have to be in tune to and think about. And then the last out for me is that I didn't design those things, so it's a tool, and then that's where we start as a prototyping tool. You build those things, and that's the artifact to think through and think with them. Because we build it, and then we start having these conversations about, hey, okay, wow, is this good or bad from a historical thinking standpoint?
Thank you.
Hi, Jennifer Hoffman,
Minnesota
Public Media.
Yeah, I've been thinking, are we about storytelling, or are we about enabling people to discover stories? And I particularly like Jim's notion of students developing apps themselves, and the trajectory of the designer and the trajectory of the historian that you see as they do that. You know, we're in this new Dewey moment in K-12 with the inquiry arc and all that stuff that argues for much more self-directed learning. And so I'm just kind of making a plea, I guess, that this technology move us in that direction. And I think a lot of it looks like it is.
Was there a question in there too, or?
No.
Just thinking out loud, one of the things there was a question. I thought that I bridged the gap, and I was just thinking that looking at the sort of financial issues, I think is an interesting thing. We're also enthusiastic, so many of us are willing to put our evenings and weekends into this sort of stuff, and I sense you do too, and you as well. And so in the long term, I'm not sure we have found a model that makes these things sustainable, meaning that people actually pay a fee for a lot of these educational apps and place-based storytelling apps, pay enough to make the whole thing sustainable. I'm not sure we're there yet. We all rely on grants and donations and so on, which is probably in the long term not necessarily the best model, I don't know, but I think that's an unsolved problem at this moment in the evolution. Sorry, I took away from it. Please.
So one of my questions throughout the conference has been, how do you measure community impact? So we saw more analytics, and every time I look at analytics, I'm always impressed by the numbers. They tell a story, but do they tell the story do they answer the question we want them to answer? Do they really tell us the kind of impact we're having? So I'd be curious to hear your thoughts on that.
I mean, I don't think that they answer that many questions, or they answer some questions, but I think that they are a good entry point for thinking about how we might want to zero in and start thinking about exactly what questions we need answered as an organization, and what questions we want answered by this product. So the numbers are just, to me, an entry point into thinking, what does this mean? If I see this number, what does that maybe suggest to me about what our users are experiencing, or if there are positive or negative things that they're having in their interactions, and then how can I go further and find out more? And I think depending on what you're looking for, that happens in a lot of different ways. But yeah, I think they're a starting point. I don't think that they're the most meaningful measurement by themselves.
I won't talk about the analytics thing, but to me another question is, what's the context in which they're being used? So I don't always think that you can just take one of these applications out of, and put it in a lab and have someone play it, and then, okay, what did you learn? What's the pre and post, or even doing controlled studies around it, which you can do in some cases. It's also what's the ecology? What's the trajectory in a class when students are using this, or when they're building this? So that it's not only about analyzing what the app is, but I think it's also the ecology and what these are being used in, particularly where projects have a mobile application as one component of all these other initiatives that are going on, or components of a larger project.
Yeah, I think Dietrich's point is an important one too, and that really crossed my mind when you were talking about how Princeton Press may have to drop the price of the app in order to sell it. I think what's been interesting to me to over the last day and a half is that when we, not within the context of this conference, think about tours, or you think about tour taking, you think about the tourism industry and that behemoth that makes a lot of money from these kinds of things. And this is not the work we've seen. These are all works of, where people have just fallen in love with the projects that they really wanted to do. So it will be interesting, and I think Detours has come up a couple of times as a company that is maybe trying to do both, and I think it's not clear whether they will figure out a way to make it viable, or whether this is still, not just for now, but even for the foreseeable future, a space where the work that's, the really rich work that's being done is just stuff that people fall in love with doing, as opposed to it being anything that, whether you're an organization or an individual, maybe it doesn't even cover the cost of one's time. I think it's still sort of early days, and I think it's a really important question.
I have a question for Jim, but this kind of reflects a little bit back on the panel. Previously, we were talking about the longevity of these projects, and I was just wondering, you were saying that RS is really like a prototyping tool for people to try out how they envision their projects, and I'm just wondering, what's the next step for them if this is just a prototype?
I frame it as a prototyping tool because not everyone, you may not even have students who you can have build things, right? Organizations don't have funds to even get off $5,000 or $1,000 to build something. So you do have a tool that allows you to say, hey, we'd like to have a QR code-based thing in our museum. Well, at least build something here and try it out. And don't even use Aris. Use Google Docs and a QR code reader just to see, is that really what you want? You're saying we want this. Let's build it, begin to get our feet wet, change the questions we're asking, et cetera. So there are people using it as a production tool. The way that I've seen that most successfully done is then they are prototyping before they're bringing in a lot of extra money. And so it's sort of a proof of concept that they can then say, now it warrants bringing in an extra $20,000 or whatever amount to come in for that. The other way that I've seen it as a prototyping tool is people have created things and then actually spun off apps based on what they learned by prototyping in Aris. I think that's another way that it allows you to have a little bit more flexibility to try some things out before you quickly, getting out the wallet and throwing money on the table. One of the interesting ones, this is all speaks of how I love a little bit to say, like, well, what QR codes might do is someone was using it as a simulation for doing like autopsy type things, and they had the tiniest little QR codes, and the only way you could actually scan them is by using a microscope attached to the phone. So instead of actually having to dissect things, they were using the QR codes to represent little components of the things. So I don't think anyone would have thought of that if they weren't if they had to spend $5,000 to make that, right? It encouraged them to actually explore and experiment.
So I wanted to return to the question of sustainability and the how to build that as part of thinking about these tours and place-based storytelling as educational, but also as something that is fundamentally part of the fabric of what it means to be a citizen, or to visit a place. And I wonder about, does anybody have experience with actually creating that, not only prototyping the app, but really scaling it? And it seems like there's a number of different examples of that. CuriateScape, there's now over 30 organizations that are using it, so that's one way of scaling something. But then, looking at what we're trying to do with Road Tour, which is to make it an app of choice that many, many different kinds of organizations in the state could both use, but also partner with us to really get their content out in a meaningful way. And it seems to me that there's some enterprise out there that's about the scaling of this kind of work. So I wonder if anybody has any thoughts about that.
Well, I think it's related to the financing question. I think that, just looking at some of the work we've been looking at that's supported by foundations, and these are grants that are, $10,000, $40,000. It's hard to think of scale. And I think, maybe it's a Detours, maybe it's a company that figures out how to take it to scale. But it's hard when the funding is coming through foundations because they're giving out, small amounts for specific projects to think about how this could be scaled up very quickly anyway. I don't know.
I guess the getting the contents out there is one big issue, and making it economically viable is in a way a parallel but separate issue. And I'm thinking of Google's Field Trip, for instance, which consolidates lots of different apps, and I could imagine our Brown Campus app, because it's free, to be loaded into that Field Trip thing, so amongst all the other apps you come across when you go in there, this could reach a much bigger audience as a result. But of course that, doesn't help us financially if we want to do the next 2.0 edition. I still have to go out and raise the funds, right? And so I think that's a very good question, and I don't see an immediate solution. It's interesting to me, just as a last thought, that maybe, our fascination with this medium is of course strong and we see all the great potential, but then I just read, probably you all read 2 days ago, the New York Times had this fascinating article that ebooks, which many publishers thought was going to kill the book and was going to be just the way we were going to consume literature, have sort of flattened out, and the book is coming back as the major device of how we consume stories. And so that gave me pause because, you know, we might have to face the fact that ultimately this is not perhaps the path that continues on, that this is just a phase that fades away and people get interested in other means of accessing knowledge. So it's fascinating to me to see that. It's also a question for me sometimes, what is it trying to scale? So if we're talking about ERIS, that's one thing, but if we're looking at the community that I'm in and we're trying to build people's care for and attention to their community and issues and sharing stories in their community, then the question becomes, what do we want to scale up at that? And it might be relationships. It might not be the tools that we're building, but what are the other things? It might be the ideas. It might be the processes, the activities of going out into the community that are scalable as opposed to the tool itself.
Yeah, it reminds me of, I think, Mark Tebow's comment earlier today. Are we putting too much on some of these programs and applications? And, you know, we wouldn't expect a single museum to scale up to a huge extent because it has a, you know, physical building. But maybe it's best for even all of these applications that they don't scale up. I mean, maybe there was something that would really be lost in terms of the personal point of view if they were taken to scale. And so, you know, I think the technology might be sort of allowing us to ask too much of it, and that, you know, asking a little less may make for more successful projects.
I think when I think about sustainability, I just because of what I study, my brain automatically goes to the actual stability of the format, and I think that is I think that's something people struggle with because it's really unknown, and I think especially when you're working with a third party who's actually providing your software, your platform, there's a lot of trust that goes into that and hoping that they continue to exist or that your content will continue to be available in that format. So I think that is sometimes hard for people who are especially used to working in the analog world. It doesn't always translate. Things in the real world decay really gracefully and digital things sort of are fine until they're not fine anymore, and that's a little stressful. I think you have to live with it small for a little while before you can scale in a really meaningful way, because you can make something that's really big right away, but you can probably save yourself a lot of effort going big in the wrong ways if you just wait it out and test, you know, a pilot first for a while.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good point. I just remember from back to behind the scenes when we were working on this and the new iOS came out, I think it was from 7 to, where are we now, 9, I think, right? So 7 to 8 or something. And of course, immediately there were glitches. The map didn't look right and the letters didn't, you know. So this is something one doesn't anticipate, that with every upgrade of an operating system,
right,
you need somebody who can go in there and fix your app so that it's still readable. And
which means you need the money to
continue to have it. So that's another aspect of sustainability. Thank you.
Sure, is there?
I think a fundamental question for these tours and indeed for any public humanities project is, how can we encourage young faculty to get involved in this? I mean, Dietrich is already well established, tenured, and renowned in this university, but many young faculty who would spend an enormous amount of time working on a project like this are not being properly rewarded for it in the tenure review system or in promotion. And I wonder how we can really encourage more involvement from young faculty. How do we give credit? How do we review and judge these types of projects, which are inherently collaborative and quite creative? I've gone through this in my career a number of times, and I think the support that we have in academia for public humanities doesn't always filter down to the junior faculty who are under review.
I had to stop myself from applauding. But it's a bigger issue around tenure, I think, in different areas. But if you think in art, you're rewarded for the art that you create. So in the games world, and even in this type of creating mobile things, you're not rewarded for the products that you're creating necessarily, maybe the research around that, but a lot of times the work of getting to the point where you can begin to do research takes, it's a big effort in order to do that. So I think one thing would be to reconsider, like having, allowing people to get credit for that, as well as the service around it. So when you're doing these types of projects, it's also service for the community and service for the university as well in the case of that. So those are at least two really small things that might work in the, for junior faculty to say, like, I'm going to actually dedicate time to this versus this other thing.
That's a very good point. I remember we've been talking about how faculty could get credit for online publications for about 10 years, and I think we've made a little bit of progress, but not as much as we should have over the last 10 years. We still give more credit to somebody writing a book that you can hold in your hand rather than something that's published online. I think where we have made progress is on the other end, there are more online journals that are peer-reviewed. That is, I think, the key word in academia, so that there's another sort of judgment that comes in to the question if something is being published or not. Of course, this is not applicable to any of our apps, really. If you put that layer in of peer review, then it takes even longer to putting them together. So I think they'll still would have problems being acknowledged as a contribution to your tenure case, probably. But it is something where a little movement has happened, but astonishingly slow. The digital world is still out there and very slow in being accepted in these traditional realms of academia. It's fascinating.
Should we drink some wine on that?
Yeah.